Thank you very much, Lalita. Good evening. It's a pleasure to be here. It's great to give a TEDx talk. And I am a physicist, and I love being a physicist. You know, back in Vienna, we had some of the sharpest microscopes in the world. The thing which you can see on the screen is an ultra-high vacuum atomic force microscope combined with a scanning tunneling microscope. And what you can do with this is you can watch the tiniest things you can imagine. So what you can see here on this next image is single graphite atoms. And the size of this whole image is 1 nanometer times 1 nanometer. So now you might ask yourself, how small is 1 nanometer? Well, if you take one of your hairs, the diameter of one of your hairs is 100,000 nanometers. So the length scale at which I was working back in Europe, back in Austria, was on the tiny itty-bitty length scale, and it was fascinating and it was wonderful. And then something happened. I went to the technology forum in Alpbach, where I heard a lecture from a man about the global challenges for humankind. You know, the biggest problems that we are currently facing on Earth. And I felt that I have to contribute to address these challenges, you know, for a better future, for humanity, for our children. And actually, to address these global challenges, which are very complex, very complicated, very interconnected and very interdependent, you cannot simply work as a specialist scientist. You need to do something which I like to call integration of knowledge across fields, across levels of education, and across cultures. And actually, now here in Malaysia, my laboratory is completely different. It's the whole rainforest. And what you can see in this image here is the so-called rafflesia flower. It can grow up to 1 meter in diameter. It has a horrible smell. You know, when you're close to it, I most of the time I had my nose closed, but just for the photograph, I put away my finger. And actually, you see, it looks like fat meat. So it attracts pollinators, bees and flies, which pollinate the flower. And what we are doing in the rainforest is I go there with people from many different fields. I have PhD students from veterinary sciences, from engineering, from biology, from the fine arts, from the applied arts, and we are going to the rainforest and we are watching and we are learning. And you might now wonder, why are we watching in the rainforest? What are we learning there? Well, actually, nature is the biggest teacher of all. When you go to living nature, you can learn so much. And actually, already Aristotle, you know, a scientist many, many thousands of years back, he said, nature does nothing uselessly. And if you remember the nice talk about the sun bear, you know, the bears crawl up and they prepare the caves for the rhinoceros birds where they have their babies. So it's all interconnected, it's all interdependent. And nature actually, over the last millions and millions of years, established a system which is sustainable, which is good, and which is working. You know, the waste of one animal is the food of another, or the fertilizer of another animal. We heard the thing about the poo of the sun bears, for example. And so when we want to address these complicated global challenges for humankind, we can learn from nature. And the basic thing which we can learn is we can learn understanding. So it's not this book knowledge which you learn when you go on a rainforest expedition, but what you learn is how the things are connected with each other, how the output of one system is the input to another system, and the output to this system is the input to the first system. So actually, there are two types of looking at living nature. When we have nature, reality, and we look at nature with our senses, with our senses, we can just see a little bit of reality with our measurement devices. So when a specialist scientist is looking at the natural system, for example, an ant specialist who knows all these long, complicated names for the ants, he gets very, very valuable information about the ants. But there's also a second approach, and this is called the so-called generalistic approach, the approach which a generalist would do. It's much broader. It's integrating the different fields, and it's trying to understand and bridge the knowledge across fields. And actually, this is the type of approach which you need if you want to approach the global challenges. And when you are doing this kind of Aristotelian approach, you know, based on understanding rather than knowledge you can read from Wikipedia or you can get from reading books, you have a little bonus, which we call the so-called Aristotelian bonus. So by being a generalist, you can understand a little bit more about the world than when you just combine specialist knowledge. And it might be that this little Aristotelian bonus helps us to address these global challenges for humankind. I'm going to show you some of them. So this is actually all 15 of them. Every year, the so-called Millennium Project identifies the 15 major global challenges for humankind. It's about 2,500 people in 60 countries who are writing down the challenges and who are also proposing ways to address these challenges. And the problem is, these challenges are not independent of each other. So if you address one or two or three or four or even 14 of these global challenges, it might be because the system is interconnected. It might be that this 15th global challenge just, you know, ruins your whole attempt. So you have to do an integrated approach. And actually, when we look at living nature, we can learn how to solve such problems. And to solve such problems, I think we need a different way of thinking. Albert Einstein was saying, you can only solve a problem with a different way of thinking that was used in generating the problem. So most of our current problems were generated by the linear Western way of thinking and of doing science. And the image which you can see here I like to use to illustrate this linear way. It's the airport in Munich, and actually it's very straight. So if you go to your terminal, you have to walk and walk and walk and walk, and you don't have any common space where you can sit together with people who are taking other flights. If you go to the airport in Jakarta, it looks completely different. It looks like grapes. So the planes are much closer to each other, and you have a common joint area where you can, you know, eat and drink, talk, enjoy yourself, and have your social relationships. And with these two images, I would like to illustrate that we need actually a combination of these two types of approaches, of the Asian, of the Eastern approach, and of the Western approach, if we want to be successful in addressing these global challenges. And you know, the global challenges are really, really pressing. We need to provide water for a growing population. We need to, we heard in this talk about Iran, we need to change the status of the women. We need to fight climate change. We need to ensure sustainable development, and so on, and so on. So it's really, really big problems. And I think we can just address them if we combine, you know, if we find new ways of dealing with problems. And a good idea, a good start to deal with these problems would be to build up a tree of knowledge where you can go from one field to the other field, independent of your level of education or of your field of specialization. This is so important because the global challenges, they are not located in physics or in chemistry or in mathematics or in biology. They are big challenges which are touching many, many different fields. So we need people who can think across these lines, who can, you know, access this tree of knowledge and understand. And actually, in the year 1750, Diderot and D'Alembert attempted to build up such a tree of knowledge. And I would like to point your attention to four words on the right side. The first one is understanding. So the major goal in this encyclopedia, where they collected all the knowledge of the time, was to understand. And there are three pillars: memory, reason, and imagination, on which this tree of knowledge can be built. And this encyclopedia already, you know, paved the way towards this tree of knowledge. Unfortunately, in the last hundreds of years, people, you know, specialized more and more and more, and they know a huge amount of data, and they have a big amount of knowledge about ever-increasing fields of specialization. This is very important, but it's very hard to bridge from one field to the next. So I think we need to breed a new type of scientist. And I'm so happy that so many young people are here, because I think you are the future, and you can try to be one of these integrative people who are not stuck in their disciplines, but who can connect the little dots and who understand what's going on and which are the problems and how we can solve them. And so in our rainforest expeditions, for example, we encounter this beautiful, beautiful butterfly. Anybody knows what this is? Yeah, exactly. It's Raja Brooks birdwing. It's the national butterfly of Malaysia. And apart from the fact that it's just a beautiful butterfly, it's a really big butterfly, you can see this nice green coloration which it has. And it sits on the fern. So the green coloration actually looks like the tips of the fern, so he's not very interested to animals who want to eat butterflies, because he looks like the tips of the wings of the fern. But there is more. He's also very, very well camouflaged. The black part around, you know, is imitating the voids between the leaves of the fern. And there is even more to this butterfly. The green is actually not green. The green is completely colorless. The green doesn't contain any chemical pigments. It doesn't contain any dyes. It's just structures which are generating the color. You know, like in the rainbow. In the rainbow, we just have the little water droplets, and the light is coming, and the light is diffracted, and you have interference phenomena, and you have all the colors of the rainbow. Or if you have a prism, and the white light is coming, and then you have all the colors of the rainbow. So he is doing a very similar thing, but with some tricks on the structure, on the surface, he just appears to be green. Unless you have a very, very bright light, you go to the butterfly park, there you have some dead of these butterflies lying around, you take a wing, you take a bright light, and you look at the wing, and you change the viewing angle. And you would see, when you have very grazing incidents and a very strong light, the green becomes blue and purple and red. So actually, this green in the butterfly is much more like a frozen rainbow than a chemical color. This blue is always blue, no matter on which angle I look at it. And actually, we can learn from this butterfly how to build colors which are not toxic. By just structuring the thing, we would put the color to. The next image shows you how he looks on a concrete surface. So he's very well adapted to the place where he used to live. So to these green surroundings, next slide please, yes, to these green surroundings where he is. And when my students are coming, and we look at this butterfly, they find a lot more things. So, for example, all the materials of his body, they were not mined somewhere in Siberia or in Argentina or in America and then brought to Malaysia and put here together, like most of our technologies. I don't want to know where the parts from for this clicker come from and how long they traveled. You know, he just uses local resources. And he just eats a little bit of nectar, drinks a little bit of water, and is building these amazing functional structures. We heard this nice talk about form and function. He has this integrated, so his forms have a certain function. And there are many more aspects you would find in the little butterfly, and actually in each and every living thing. This one, does anybody know what this is? It's the Selaginella fern. It's very common in the Malaysian rainforest. And again, the blue is not real chemical blue. It's a structural blue. He has a very thin layer, just a couple of tens of nanometers thin. You know now what a nanometer is. The hair is 100,000 nanometers in diameter. And so this thin layer, via interference of the light, causes the blue coloration. So if you go into the jungle, for example, Malaysian Nature Society, they have a little track, just 500 meters, you would see this. And if you take the leaves and if you tilt them, they would change color from blue to green and back to blue. And actually, this blue has a function. It's a photoprotection, you know. The light in the tropics is very, very intense, so it protects the chloroplast in the plant, this blue coloration. And there are iridescent plants and fruits in Malaysia, in Australia, in many tropical countries. And what you can see here is actually, it's the physics which are generating the colors. You have this thin layer system. And like in an oil film on water, you know, where the coloration comes just from the light playing with this thin layer, you get from the light playing with these many thin layers. Here in the iridosome of iridescent fruits, you get these amazingly beautiful colors. And you might have friends who have butterflies in their offices at home, and they have the butterflies next to the books. And the books bleach, you know, the backside of the book, they become blue and gray after some decades, after 20 or 30 years. But the butterflies, they stay as beautiful as on the first day, because these chemical colors bleach, whereas the structural colors of certain butterflies never bleach. They are always as bright and as beautiful as on the first day. And of course, also the coloration of soap bubbles is generated via this playing with the light. And so here I have a movie of a soap bubble. In the soap bubble, we don't have any pigments. It's just playing off the light with the structures. When the bubble gets thinner and thinner and thinner, you know, the coloration changes from the red towards the blue. And actually, we can transfer this. You know, biomimetics, which I have in the title of my talk, biomimetics deals with the transfer of this knowledge from living nature to applications in science and technology. And there are even iridescent animals. Well, it's hard to say. He is actually neither an animal nor a plant. It's called slime molds. He's an iridescent slime mold. And it's very, very small, just a couple of millimeters in size. And I included this organism into this presentation because it has a really interesting life cycle. And I would like to tell you a bit about the life cycle. And I would like you, in your mind, to make a connection with how we can address the global challenges. So this slime mold actually are single cells, which are very happy, and every little single cell is independent and is eating and is having fun and is happy. But if they have a shortage of food, they come together and they build one organism. Every single cell gives up its independence. They are becoming interdependent. And this organism is then building a big stalk. On top of this big stalk is a sphere. This would then explode and would send the new life out as far away as possible from this place where you have the shortage of food. And this is illustrated here. And I'll show you some slides about the animals which we encounter when we're doing our rainforest expeditions. This is a longhorn beetle from Borneo. And apart from the fact that he's just a beauty, he is having everything. He has sensors, he can see, he can fly, he can detect mates, he can replicate, he's armored, he has this mandible so he can eat. He even has sensors for the polarization of the skylight. It's the things which you can see up here. So it's a wonder in itself, and it's just a little beetle. And with one of my students, we developed a concept for a new robot, And in the first approach, we were just transferring the form, which you can see here, so it just looks like the beetle. But that's not all. If you just transfer the shape, the form, it's nice, it's interesting, it's beautiful, but there's much more to this beetle. So what we were also transferring in a later stage is the sensors for the polarization. So like the bees, you know, who fly away from their hives, and then they find the honey, and then they go straight back to the hives. So this beetle is doing the same. He, or this beetle robot, he can do whatever he's doing, and then when he wants to go home, he goes straight back home, following the polarization of the skylight. And the next organism which I would like to show you is the so-called sunbeam snake from Borneo. It shows very, very beautiful rainbow coloration. And the second to last image is a glass-making algae, which is biomineralizing glass in cold water. So this thing is living in cold water and is making glass. And you know, if we just would learn from these organisms how to make glass at normal temperature, not at hundreds of degrees, as we do it now. And I come to the last slide, and the last slide is actually an invitation. So if anybody of you would like to join us on a rainforest expedition, just write me an email, and I will be very happy if you join us. Thank you.